I want to thank, too, Professor Young for this wonderful paper. He sort of indicated I got so excited that I perhaps very stupidly said the things that I was most excited about, and then got a new version of the paper where he had addressed those so elegantly. So he's pushed me to go beyond, and we'll see what I do with that. I'm intrigued by the invitation because I've been an admirer of Professor Young's work for years, and also because cultural translation as a working concept, including Professor Young's previous work, has helped me as a translator and as a translation and post-colonial studies theorist. This work takes into account those hierarchies and historical relationships between the languages and cultures, crucially, between language and culture and historical relationships between the language and cultures that crucially affect the connotation of a given word choice. And one example I was thinking of is retaining the Tamil word pariah in an English translation, knowing that that word has been appropriated into the English lexicon with very different connotations in a move that's similar, thank you very much, and very similar to what we just heard about culture and culture. One of my concerns, however, about the ways cultural translation is often used, that this paper elegantly sidesteps, is that the agents, or one could say subjects, of those translations are often objectified, treated as nameless bodies carried across, as it were. Instead, in this paper, Professor Young rethinks the question of translational agency, even though he just claimed that he's not doing that. I think he is. He suggests that Freud's contributions to translation theory have important implications for those translated subjects often left out of theorizing, as he just suggested in the discussion, the interpretation of dreams. Freud's theoretical paradigm, so I'm repeating what you just heard because I want to think about it more. It's a really challenging idea. Freud's theoretical paradigm on translation remains infinitely suggestive. It offers, for example, a possible way of reading the invisible, the subaltern, those whose forms of public representation distort their fundamental being, or the invisibility or repression of subalterns in official discourses and documents from the past require a de-translation exercise to make them visible in their own terms. But what are those terms? Translation in this paper means so many different things and conflicting things. The net effect, I think, and an exceedingly productive one, is to call into question the relationship of language to culture, of original to translation. This reading of Freud invites us to rethink the terms of a translator's invisibility, to borrow Venuti's famous phrase, even as the origin and therefore meaning of the translation itself may be highly individualized and invisible, in part because hidden most particularly from the translated subject herself. Young's reading insists that psychoanalysis necessarily involves a tension between an individual's own terms and official discourse. The work of analysis is to put those in conversation with one another so that each person's fundamental being finds a form of public representation with less distortion, and I would add, less alienation and even anguish. The focus of much scholarly discussion of psychoanalysis has been on one side of the conversation, weighted toward the way the language we have in common as a culture, here public representation, can help an individual overcome hysteria, say. Professor Young's proposition here in this quotation is that we might think more about the ways the individual struggles to articulate difficult truths might put protective pressures on this language we have in common. His reading of Freud insists that translation practice is at the core of our work as language beings, regardless of how many official languages we are said to speak, and that one of the central roles of culture is to train an individual to interpret to themselves, in a language they share with others, the most hidden parts of themselves. What disciplinary strategies can help us interpret attentively and responsibly the multiple displacements of these different meanings of cultural translation? To understand how we might begin de-translating those subjects, often rendered invisible, we might begin by noticing the ways the internal displacements Freud was interested in investigating and helping to relieve can be mapped onto the global displacement scholars in post-colonial and migrant studies have been looking into more recently, as Professor Young has suggested here. he begins by looking more closely at the mechanisms of these internal displacements. And one of the things I've been kind of thinking about is how we even discuss the difference between, or how do we think about those different internal places that are working to be displaced. He takes as his first example of the translated subject, Anna O. Here, as in many of the examples Professor Young discussed today, multilinguality becomes a means of displacement and translation or detranslation, the cure. We see in Nicola Lockhart's 2004 translation of Brewer's case study that her language use signaled her historical episodes. The paraphasia receded, but now she spoke only in English, yet seemed to be unaware of it and quarrel with the nurse. This is the same one he quoted a part of. She seemed unaware of and would quarrel with the nurse, who was, of course, unable to understand her. Not until several months later did I manage to convince her that she was speaking English. She herself, however, still understood her German-speaking environment. Only in moments of great anxiety would her speech fail her completely, or she would mix up all kinds of languages. She would speak French or Italian at those times when she was at her best and most free. Between those periods and those in which she spoke English lay complete amnesia. How can we read into this description of Professor Young's proposition that Freud's theoretical paradigm offers a possible way of reading the invisible, the subaltern, that is, what does an upper-class multilingual subject like Anna teach us about invisible translated subjects? One partial answer to this question is that the details, for example, call into question the neat demarcations between interlingual and intralingual translation theorist Roman Jakobson lays out in his 1959 essay on linguistic aspects of translation, and that Professor Young mentioned in the paper today. Anna's example is important because of the ways it confounds set linguistic categories. I say this with special conviction because of an experience I had teaching Jakobson's essay a few years back that seems relevant here and that this paper has given me insight into. In both an undergraduate translation workshop I ran and in a small graduate discussion group on autobiographical writing, three of my students independently applied the category of intersemiotic translation Jakobson lists to what they refer to as the translation of memory. Not incidentally, at least all were bilingual, and two of the three had grown up in multilingual households. One of the students went on to write his master's degree thesis on the subject. For these students, the stuff of memory they themselves contended with felt not so much lingual as semiotic, and thus, to my understanding, more akin to Freud's reading of original meaning as a pictographic script, which Freud suggests in his discussion of the case of Katerina. And again, Professor Young just quoted, we were able to read once we had discovered a few cases of bilingualism. Professor Young extends this idea toward the end of his talk when he reflects on the ambivalence individuals feel towards the refinements of cultures, of culture, those who experience the repression of their natural instincts and the satisfaction of social acceptability as, quote, what is both lost and gained in translation. He goes on to observe that the multilingualism of Anna O can illuminate how, and I'm quoting him, in this model, the general sense of loss in translation modifies its gain, for while in cultural terms much is gained, in the individual this gain produces at the same time a constant sense of unease, of dis-ease, malaise, of cultural frustration, cultural denial, or we might say today of cultural dislocation, of nostalgia for the past that has been suppressed, and Freud suggests at the end of the book, guilt, close quote. I was very intrigued by this discussion of guilt in this context, including, I think it got, anyway, it's his remark that explains Freud's interest in the traditory witticism, but I wondered how we might understand that tension if we imagine those translations differently, not between individual languages and shared culture, for example, but original meaning as multilingual, semiotic, or something else. We might notice, if we return to the passage from Anna O's case study, that not only she... if we return to the passage from Anna O's case study, that not only she, but we are being enculturated through this work of analysis. I draw your attention to the line where Breuer writes, not only, now she spoke only in English, yet she seemed to be unaware of it, and would quarrel with the nurse who was, of course, unable to understand her. That of course, which appears in both Strachey's and Lockhart's translations, draws my attention in particular, since it assumes a certain superiority over the hardworking nurse struggling to care for her ward. It invites me to join the ranks of the multilingual elite who can move fluently between German and English. A page later, Breuer tells us that the nurse soon learns enough English to communicate with Anna. The scene raises two related questions. First, how do we contend with what Talal Asad describes in his 1985 essay on the concept of cultural translation in British social anthropology as the fundamental inequality between languages? And secondly, as posed by Asad in the same essay, how does power enter into the process of cultural translation, seen as both a discursive and as a non-discursive practice? I would like to spend some time putting Young's paper in conversation with Asad's critique of the discursive practices in the field of anthropology in the mid-80s. And by the way, I noticed when Professor Young was talking about this, that is exactly when culture translation sort of went out of favor and came into favor in postcolonial theory. And I'm aware of that. So that's part of what I'm trying to think through here, is how to avoid driving this term into the ground the way that the anthropologists did. But that's the sort of unofficial version of what I'm trying to do here. So I'm putting these two in conversation in order to think more carefully about his proposition that cultural translation can be an interdisciplinary humanistic endeavor that takes into account various local linguistic interventions. Asad understands implicitly that the discursive practice of cultural translation does indeed involve a version of interlingual transfer, as well as intralingual crossing in the way Professor Young reads into Anna's example. Asad takes this a step further by adding to the list of representational practice disciplinary convention. Now I'll get the slide that you saw before. When anthropologists return to their countries, they must write up their people. And they must do so in the conventions of representation already circumscribed by their discipline, institutional life, and wider society. Cultural translation must accommodate itself to a different language, not only in the sense of English as opposed to Dinka or English as opposed to Kabashi Arabic, but also in the sense of a British middle-class academic game as opposed to the modes of life of the tribal Sudan. In the case of ethnography, the translation is addressed to a very specific audience, which is waiting to read about another mode of life and to manipulate the text it reads according to established rules, not to learn to live a new mode of life. Of course, one of the primary differences between the protocols of ethnography and of psychoanalysis is that the analyst and, according to what we have heard today, does or emphatically does not want to use the process of translation to learn to live a new mode of life. This ambivalence toward translation, Professor Young outlines in his paper, is very much at odds with the self-convinced position of the anthropologist Asad is critiquing, and this ambivalence seems to offer a much-needed disciplinary flexibility to those of us thinking about cultural translation in the humanities, who would like to apply the transformations associated with psychoanalysis to more global transformations, interventions, resistances. How might this work? In his 1985 essay, Asad is concerned that in the case of anthropology, the inequality of languages comes to impinge on these transformations. If you substitute post-colonial for third world, as I read a few lines from his work, you will recognize that Asad's concerns are exceedingly and disappointingly current. This is Asad writing. To put it crudely, because the languages of third world societies, including, of course, the societies that social anthropologists have traditionally studied, are weaker in relation to Western cultures, and today especially to English, they are more likely to submit to forcible transformation in the translation process than the other way around. The reason for this is, first, that in their political economic relations with third world countries, Western nations have the greater ability to manipulate the latter. And second, Western languages produce and deploy desired knowledge more readily than third world languages do. I've quoted this passage countless times over the years, but it was only in looking at it again through the lens of Professor Young's paper, comparing the scene of ethnographic representation with the scene of analysis, that I realized what an important role the desire for knowledge plays in these encounters, how acutely it becomes part of the equation when tabulating the relative value of languages in relation to one another and their potential for transformation in the contact zone. How do we understand the currency of desired knowledge and cultural translation in the way Professor Young is positing, given that he acknowledges that we never, in a sense, get to the original work as such, only to a third text, the analyst's rephrasing of its meaning? Significantly for us, later in his essay, Usad warns us away from making an analogy between cultural practices and linguistic patterns, as Mary Douglas does in Purity of Danger that he cites, I should say targets. Linguistic patterns are not meanings to be translated, he insists. They are rules to be systematically described and analyzed. This claim about linguistic patterns and meaning is not something I'm interested in defending, but rather applying to cultural translation as a humanistic project. Usad is suspicious of the ethnographer's claim that she can read into these cultural practices implicit and therefore essential meaning. He charges that the difference between a linguist and an anthropologist is that the linguist, quote, is faced with a specific piece of discourse produced within the society studied, close quote, while an anthropologist, quote, must construct the discourse as a cultural text in terms of meanings implicit in a range of practices, close quote. If we accept Usad's characterizations, then I would add that the difference between a linguist and a literary scholar is that the latter takes a specific piece of discourse produced in the society studied and treats it as a cultural text in terms of meanings implicit in a range of practices. That is, I would see this contingency as a virtue. I certainly do in Jung's reading of Freud, and find especially productive his suggestion that, quote, what is distinct about this process of cultural translation, and he's referring here to civilization as discontents, is that in Freud, the translated elements of sexuality in particular never disappear even in the translated person, for they reappear retranslated in dreams, and for those whose translations have not been entirely successful, in the symptoms of hysteria and neurosis. So it is not a question of translation as in moving from text A to B, leaving A behind, but rather moving to text B by making text A unconscious, repressed, but with A still haunting text B as its shadow and liable to appear in disguised form at any moment. This detailed focus on the psychic life of the translated subject, as I like to think of it, forces us to redefine the relationship of translation to original, and in the process, the authority of the act of interpretation. Significantly for us, Usad goes on to charge that the work of the anthropologist, quote, identifying unconscious meanings in the task of cultural translation is better compared to the activity of the psychoanalysis than to that of the linguist. In Jung's paper, I see a wonderful rejoinder to the implicit question Usad poses, what is the task of cultural translation? Professor Jung's reading of Freud suggests that we are seeking to cure a widespread case of paraphasia and then making that very project invisible to ourselves. So I was kind of thinking about your reading of the kind of failed translation of the hypnoid state as an example of that. I find myself now asking, how do Professor Jung's insights translate into academic discourse? Usad ends his essay by puzzling over the robustness of an approach to cultural translation which he charges is faulty and unethical. He wonders over its success, quote, is it perhaps because they are intimidated by a style? We know, of course, he emphasizes style. We know, of course, that anthropologists, like other academics, learn not merely to use a scholarly language, but to fear it, to admire it, to be captivated by it. Yet this does not tell us why such a scholarly style should capture so many intelligent people. Mm-hmm. Usad surmises that what we have here is a style easy to teach. to learn and to reproduce. It is a style that facilitates the textualization of other cultures, that encourages the construction of diagrammic answers to complex cultural questions, and that is well suited to arranging foreign cultural concepts in clearly marked heaps of sense and nonsense. Such a style must surely be at a premium in an established university discipline that aspires to standards of subjective objectivity, close quote. He's suggesting, I think, that we are all affected on a number of levels by the inequality between languages, and all infected by our own desire for knowledge, wanting to have command over situations that may appear overwhelming and nonsensical. Usad's skepticism over the role objectivity plays in giving authority to the easy interpretations of the first world ethnographer is a handy reminder here, and I think also helps give us some idea why the question why Freud as translation theorist doesn't have more currency if this is what we actually want, is something that's easier and more diagrammic. If we are committed to seeking a new way of reading the invisible, the subaltern, those whose forms of public representation distort their fundamental being through Freud's ideas on cultural translation, we need to be more attentive to our own tasks as readers of translation, cultural and otherwise. Bruno Bettelheim, writing just 2 years before Usad, was just as skeptical of easy answers in psychoanalysis and likewise of the role objectivity plays in psychoanalytic encounter. I bring up Bettelheim not to argue over the English translations, Bettelheim's discussion of the interpretation. I bring up Bettelheim not to argue over the English translations of Freud's work, but instead to revisit Bettelheim's discussion of the interpretation of Freud for a different ends, to suggest that Bettelheim's reading of Freud as compassionate humanist rather than objective scientist would help make a stronger case for Freud's theories of cultural translation as a critical reading practice. This is inspired in part by Lawrence Venuti's characterization in The Translator's Invisibility of Bettelheim's critique of Strachey's overly scientistic translation of Freud in the standard edition of the series. For Venuti, Bettelheim's critique offers us an example of an alternative humanism, one that is foreignizing rather than domesticating. This alternative humanism is grounded in a subjectivity, quote, constituted by cultural and social determinations that are diverse and even conflicting, that mediate any language use and that vary with every cultural formation and every historical moment. I'd like to bring together Professor Young's interest in making visible subalterns with Venuti's interest in making the practicing translator herself more visible in order to think more carefully about the subjectivity of the translated subject as a relational prospect. Just got a little bit more here. In his 1983 monograph, Freud and Man's Soul, Bettelheim lambasts Strachey for the many rhetorical choices he makes to have Freud appear less of a humanist and more of a medical scientist. His chief complaint is the effect on the field of psychoanalysis in the US, which he asserts misunderstands Freud's aims. Bettelheim is concerned primarily that this approach estranges the analyst, makes him treat his patients from a distance rather than seeing them as fellow human beings who have experienced something similar to their own struggles. He writes, in the interpretation of dreams, which open to our understanding not just the meaning of dreams, but also the nature and power of the unconscious, Freud told about his arduous struggle to achieve even greater self-awareness. In other books, he told why he felt it was necessary for the rest of us to do the same. In a way, all his writings are gentle, persuasive, often brilliantly worded intimations that we, his readers, would benefit from a similar spiritual journey of self-discovery. Unfortunately, nobody who reads him in English could guess this. While Bettelheim doesn't use the specific word style, he suggests that part of the power of Freud's approach is rhetorical. For Bettelheim, this distancing is created most effectively in the high register abstractions Strachey relies on. One vivid example he refers to is the use of uterus instead of womb. Bettelheim comments, the wish to substitute a medical term for a word in ordinary use leads to the replacement of a word that has deep emotional associations with one that evokes hardly any. Who would want to crawl back into a uterus? In my terminology, the scientistic approach contributes rather than rather to a kind of cultural, at least academic, paraphasia, where we distance ourselves from the translated subject. Bettelheim, for his part, writes, "The biggest shortcoming of the translations is that through their use of abstractions, they make it easy for the reader to distance himself from what Freud sought to teach about the inner life of man and of the reader himself. Almost invariably, I have found that psychoanalytic concepts had become for these students a way of looking only at others from a safe distance, nothing that had any bearing on them. They observed other people through the spectacles of abstraction, tried to comprehend them by means of intellectual concepts, never turning their gaze inward to the soul or their own unconscious." What I would like to suggest in closing, however, is that the difference in these two interpretations of Freud, scientistic versus humanistic, should be taken as emblematic of a similar choice we have before us today as we consider what cultural translation might add to the study of translation as cultural event, as interlingual event, rather than distance ourselves from the individual struggles of a translated subject like Honor or one of my students. I would urge us to strengthen the theoretical models that would allow the tension between an individual's, quote, own terms and official discourse to become part of the critical language we develop as theorists of cultural translation. Thank you.